In this episode, we're going to break down the construction of a typical foam and fiberglass surfboard to understand the general concept and resulting qualities. In a later episode, we'll talk about some of the interesting alternative construction techniques and materials that are available, but for now, let's keep it simple. A surfboard's core is typically made from a plastic foam blank, which is shaped into what might resemble a surfboard and then covered by a skin of glass fibers and resin. Running through the centre of the foam is normally a single strip of wood called the stringer that adds strength and rigidity to the board. Taking several materials, capitalising on their qualities and layering them up is known as sandwich construction, although within the surf industry we tend to reserve this term for boards with multi-layered skins. In a surfboard's case, this construction style makes a structural steel like an I-beam, and this contributes to the surfboard's mighty strength to weight ratio. It's the ideal system for surfboards as the inner core is thick, light and buoyant, while the outer skin is thin, strong and stiff. When we look at variations in this construction method, different approaches will affect the weight, strength and flex pattern of the finished board. Depending on construction, the weight of a finished board is split about 50-50 between the skin and core materials. The stringer accounts for just a very small percentage of the final weight, but it's the combination of the skin and stringer that accounts for most of the board's strength and flexibility. First off, let's consider the stringer as it's the quickest to explain. Again, the stringer is the strip of wood that runs the length of a standard fiberglass board, and it's there because without it, the board would probably flex beyond the tolerances of the core and skin materials. Essentially, it's there to prevent the board from snapping. With that in mind, it's obvious the stringer has an important part in determining how much the board will flex whilst being ridden. And although surfboards may feel very rigid, they can flex an amazing amount whilst you're on board. To increase the surfboard strength, especially on longer boards, the stringer width can be increased or more stringers can be added to cope with the increased stress. And in the longboard era of the 50s and 60s, it wasn't uncommon to have a three-stringer board for maximum strength. Stringers have been made from a variety of wood over the years, with plywood being most common for many years. Balsa and cedar are also popular, along with regional woods such as basswood or redwood within the USA. Balsa is a favourite nowadays on performance shortboards thanks to its light weight, but shapers often opt for different varieties of wood based on a particular aesthetic since the weight of any stringer is pretty low. Using a strip of wood has its limitations. The main one would be that the flex will vary depending on the grain of the wood, which is mostly hidden within the wood itself. A knot in the wood could stiffen the flex pattern in one area, potentially making the board more or less desirable to ride. This might not be a huge problem, but if you want to make a copy of the board with the same flex pattern, all of a sudden you have something frustratingly unique and immeasurable. If you've ever snapped a board and investigated its contents, then you may be familiar with the inner core. Typically a plastic foam material, the core is mostly there to create the shape of the surfboard that the skin can then be formed around. But it does also contribute to the overall strength of the board. By increasing the density or the stiffness of the foam, we can strengthen the board without hugely affecting its flexibility. Some pro surfers seek out lower density blanks with a lower weight for a high performance board, or high density blanks with a higher weight for a big wave board. A towing board's core might weigh as much as 5 times that of a normal surfboard, allowing the rider to carry more momentum or be less upset by choppy conditions. Polyurethane foam has been the standard core material since its creation in the 50s. Due to the handmade nature of surfboards at the time, shapers were looking for something lighter and easier to shape than wood. Polyurethane foam is wonderfully easy to work with due to the fine structure of the material, so shapers can easily make micrometer adjustments using standard woodworking tools. Polyurethane foam comes in different densities, but the standard for a surfboard is normally between 2 to 3 pounds per cubic foot. 1 cubic foot is approximately 28 litres. So that means the core of a 28-litre PU surfboard weighs around 2-3 pounds, at least 4 times lighter than the lightest balsa wood boards. So what are the problems? Well, its compressive strength is low, so a small concentrated pressure from your feet crushes it easily. Those dings don't just have an aesthetic impact, but a volume-reducing one too, potentially stealing some tenths of a litre from the original total volume. Another problem with polyurethane is that if the outer skin is compromised through a ding or crack, the foam will absorb water. This can lead to the breakdown of the foam, yellowing or brittleness. Finally, while the surfboards are pretty terrible for the environment in general, polyurethane boards may be the worst. The foam production creates some nasty chemicals, while the finished product can take 100,000 years to break down once discarded, and there are very limited options for recycling. These reasons all contribute to an increase in the use of expanded polystyrene, or EPS as it's known, as a material for the core. EPS is the foam you find packed around your TV or lining a beer cooler, and is even cheaper than polyurethane. It's also stiffer, and a higher core stiffness directly improves the strength of the board. Although not all strength comes from the core, a sizable amount does, and so since EPS is a stiffer, stronger material, you can use a lighter foam to get the same strength. Therefore, a standard EPS core might be around 1 to 2 pounds per cubed foot, which can dramatically lighten the finished surfboard. EPS does have its problems though. It can take on a lot of water due to the gaps between the small beads. A few companies are trying to fuse the beads together in an effort to reduce this. But the big problem is that it's more difficult to shape, as using traditional tools and techniques makes the foam flake and fall apart. Instead, shapers use a kind of hot knife or cheese wire to carve and melt the foam, a time-consuming process for hand shapers. Another method is to form the board in a mold, which is more suited to mass manufacturing, and less to low unit shapers, which also obviously reduces the options for customization. EPS blanks are a fraction more eco-friendly than PU foam, if only because the material is more recyclable. The outer skin is typically made from fiberglass, or more technically, glass-reinforced plastic, since fiberglass is actually a trade name like Hoover or Kleenex. A fiberglass skin is actually a composite material, made by soaking woven glass fibers with a liquid plastic resin, which then hardens. The fibers provide the strength and stiffness, whilst the cured resin binds the fibers together and becomes waterproof. There are two types of resins used in this process. The first is polyester and the second is epoxy. These two resins do have differing properties. So let's start with the more traditional option of polyester. Polyester resin has been used in boat building for many years, and so it's cheap, quick, and easy to work with. You can also add chemicals to control the speed of hardening. There are a few downsides. The hardening agent is extremely toxic, and as the resin cures, it's really smelly. Age causes a yellowing of board that's not just cosmetic with polyester resin. It may also signify a weakening in the material as UV light causes it to become more and more brittle and likely to crack. Finally, polyester resin can't be used on EPS cores as it melts through the foam. Epoxy is a much better resin for surfboard construction, and yes, epoxy boards are also fiberglass. It has a higher impact resistance and doesn't degrade in the same way as polyester. So any yellowing is more a cosmetic downfall rather than a reduction in the board's integrity. Epoxy also works better as a bonding agent within the construction and can have a 20% better bond to the core, so delaminations are less frequent in epoxy surfboards. Epoxy can be used with any of the core materials and there are many odorless versions available. Sadly, the drying process is not as controllable and can vary with humidity and temperature, so many factories are forced to cure the boards in climate-controlled rooms. But the big problem with epoxy really comes down to the price. It's 3 to 4 times more expensive than polyester for the little gain in strength. Strangely, the other component of fiberglass is made of the same glass you find in your home windows, but formed into fine strands that are woven into a fabric cloth. There are several types of glass fiber. E-glass is the most common, as it's the cheapest and easiest to weave. The E stands for electrical, as the product was originally formulated for electrical insulation. You may also hear of S-glass. The S stands for strength, and using S-glass can make your board up to 10% stronger and stiffer at the same weight. However, it's more expensive and so not as common. The woven cloth is typically measured in weight per square yard of a given thickness. 4 or 6 ounces are the standard weights, which means they weigh 4 ounces per square yard or 6 ounces per square yard. Usually a square yard is similar in size to a standard chalkboard, and so the calculations are quite straightforward. The only complication is that those are dry weights. Heavier weaves will soak up more resin, and removing excess resin is an important part of the process. A good glass job should balance the cloth and the resin about 1 to 1. So a yard of 4 ounce cloth will use about 4 ounces of resin. This means the skin on a shortboard with one layer of 4 ounce cloth on the deck and bottom might weigh about 16 ounce or 1 pound in total. Now the downside is that 1 4 ounce layer would be quite weak. Using heavier cloth would increase both strength and weight proportionally, but fiberglass is incredibly efficient at increasing strength by adding layers. For every additional layer of cloth added, there is a 300% increase in strength and stiffness, with only a 25% increase in the weight of the board. Typically, therefore, most shapers put extra layers on the deck to add strength and to protect the core from our heavy feet. This is where the core and skin relationship really comes together. By using a lighter core, you can add more fibers and resins to make a much stronger board for the same weight. In the next episode, we're going to add into this mix some of the more recent material and construction innovations like vacuum bagging, carbon fibers, parabolic stringers, and skeletal framed hollow surfboards. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you then.